Good morning and welcome to Bishop Auckland Methodist Church for our Sunday worship today. And the preacher and leader of our worship is Mrs. Vanessa Purdy.
You more than gold or silver.
Only you can satisfy. She's singing to Christ in that hymn. She's singing to Jesus, looking to him more than to anything else. And today's theme, set your hearts on things that are in heaven. Where Christ is, Colossians will go on to say. We want to put our hearts there. We want to put our minds there this morning and have the Lord speak to us. Welcome to all of you who are listening on radio on Bishop FM 105.9, Bishop FM. Welcome to those who are listening and watching on YouTube. And welcome to those who are in building. We want to worship Christ this morning. We want to give him the glory and find the strength that comes from him for every day. And we know that he is the one who will cure all his children's warring madness. He'll bend our pride to his control if we allow him. Shame, Lord, our wanton selfish gladness. Let us not be rich in things and poor in soul, that you may grant us wisdom and grant us courage. Come, all you who are trying to make sense of the world, look up, focus on Christ, and find everything you need in him. We sing our first hymn, God of Grace and God of Glory.
God of Grace and God of Glory, on your people pour your blessing.
Your lights in this world. Labels put on us by society and the world have been torn up. You accept us all. Our old self has been shed and the new put on. And for that reason, Lord Jesus, we want to praise your name. For you sit at the right hand of God. And as new creations in you, we draw near to you this morning, a community, worshipfully seeking more of you together. But we also come, Lord Jesus, to confess to you. For you are the only one who is perfect. We all have bad habits of some description. It might simply be just biting the nails or leaving the top off the toothpaste, dropping wet towels on the floor. But there are some habits, Lord Jesus, that go so much deeper. Addictions, excesses, gossiping, impatience, intolerance, malice, greed, lies. Lord Jesus, forgive us our failings, our own futile attempts to break free of the habits that continue to grip us. We need you, Lord Jesus, to point them out and help us overcome. For with you we can conquer anything. So, Lord Jesus, forgive us when our behavior lapses and our eyes look down. Help us to continuously raise our eyes up to you, you who will help us to worship by acting out our faith. And not just speaking of it. Thank you, Lord Jesus, that just as the sun rises on each new day, so we too can start afresh each day with you. And for that, we give you praise. And we have a prayer of adoration and praise that we want to bring you this morning. And if you can respond with the words in the white type, the words that say, our hearts soar with adoration and praise. Join with us, if you can, listening on the radio. Our hearts soar with adoration and praise. Our hearts are hidden with Christ in God, in whose image we were made.
Our hearts soar with adoration and praise.
We give thanks for your Son, Jesus Christ, who set us free and whose name rings with the wisdom and the riches of heaven.
Our hearts soar with adoration and praise.
We praise you, Jesus, for transforming us and setting our minds heavenward.
Our hearts soar with adoration and praise.
In and through you, we have hope for the future.
our hearts soar with adoration and praise. Amen.
Amen. And so we conclude our prayers with the prayer that Jesus taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen.
Cliff is going to come and read to us. He's going to read to us from the book of Ecclesiastes, which gives so much wisdom, even though sometimes the philosopher speaking there goes on about it all being useless. Thank you, Cliff.
I'm reading various verses from chapter 1 and chapter 2. It is useless, useless, said the philosopher. Life is useless, all useless. I, the philosopher, have been king of Israel in Jerusalem. I determined that I would examine and study all the things that are done in this world. God has laid a miserable fate upon us. I have seen everything done in this world, and I tell you, it is all useless. It is like chasing wind. Nothing that I had worked for and earned meant a thing to me, because I knew that I would have to leave it to my successor. And he might be wise, or he might be foolish, who knows? Yet he will own everything I have worked for. Everything my wisdom has earned for me in this world, it is all useless. So I came to regret that I had worked so hard. You worked for something for which your wisdom, knowledge, and skill, and then you have to leave it all to someone who hasn't had to work for it. It is useless, and it isn't right. You work and worry your way through life, and what do you have to show for it? As long as you live, everything you do brings nothing but worry and heartache. Amen.
Amen. We work for something with all our wisdom and knowledge and skill that we can have, but then we have to leave it all. What a bothersome task. But we're called to wisely apply ourselves, and then thinking about things in heaven and building up our treasures there rather than here on earth. We need to be content with what we have, whether it's little or much, because our contentment is not on our possessions. Our contentment can be in Jesus. And when we find that contentment, it goes on and on and on. And that is what we should desire. Niamh is singing an old song for us. He that is down may fear no fall. It's a hymn that is written by John Bunyan, the author of A Pilgrim's Progress, that really old but such a good story that helps us understand the journey of faith.
Down bids fear no fall, hear that is low no pride, hear that is humble ever shall. touch, and Lord, contentment still I crave, because thou savest such. From first to such a burden is, that go on pilgrimage, here little and hereafter bliss, is best from age to age.
We need to be constantly renewed. Constantly renewed because we find it hard to keep our eyes firmly fixed on Jesus. Yet he will renew us every time we look up to him and find that our wisdom comes from him when our hearts are set on him in heaven. Cliff will read to us from Colossians chapter 3.
You have been raised to life with Christ, so set your hearts on the things that are in heaven, where Christ sits on the throne at the right side of God. Keep your minds fixed on things there, not on things here on earth. For you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. Your real life is Christ, and when he appears, then you too will appear with him and share his glory. You must put to death, then, the earthly desires that work in you, such as sexual immorality, indecency, lust, evil passions, and greed, for greed is a form of idolatry. Because of such things, God's anger will come upon those who do not obey him. At one time, you yourselves used to live according to such desires, where your life was dominated by them. But now you must get rid of all these things, anger, passion, and hateful feelings. No insults or obscene talk must ever come from your lips. Do not lie to one another, for you have put off the old self with its habits and have put on the new self. This is the new being which God, its creator, is constantly renewing in his own image, in order to bring you to a full knowledge of himself. As a result, there is no longer any distinction between Gentiles and Jews, circumcised and uncircumcised, barbarians, savages, slaves and free, but Christ is all. Christ is in all. Amen.
Amen. Thanks be to God. Thank you, Cliff, for reading that. And if it just doesn't seem like wisdom because you don't understand it, come and join us on a Tuesday afternoon at 2:00, where we're studying the book of Colossians at the moment. You can join on Zoom or in person in the building. But it is good to want to know about God's wisdom and to understand his word more, because it helps. It helps, and what helps even more is when we set our eyes on Jesus and ask him to come and be with us and fill us with his goodness. It is our faith in him that really makes the difference. It's like, as the message said, our old life is like a filthy set of ill-fitting clothes that we strip off and put in the fire when we come to Jesus. And he dresses us in a new wardrobe. Every item of our new way of life is custom made by the Creator with his label on it. And all the old fashions are obsolete. I love the way that the message puts that. But we look to Christ to give us the standards that we need, but he doesn't leave us alone and say, don't do that, don't do that, don't do that, don't do that. He comes and he helps us. He's there with us. He gives us the strength that we need. And in him, we can find that contentment. As we think of that, we're going to sing another hymn. And the verse that I want you to think about most says, "Send down your likeness from above, and let this my adorning be. Clothe me with wisdom, patience, love, with lowliness and purity, than gold and pearls more precious far, and brighter than the morning star." May God give us the wisdom that we are offered in Jesus. O God, what offering shall I give? Gospel of Luke, and here we have a parable of Jesus that he told, and he is echoing, or should I say Paul was echoing Jesus in the Colossians reading, when he was saying we need to get rid of greed as one of those qualities that isn't part of the wisdom that Jesus will give us from heaven. And this is why greed is not a good idea. Luke chapter 12 and verses 13 to 21. A man in the crowd said to Jesus, "Teacher, Tell my brother to divide with me the property our father left us. Jesus answered, Friend, who gave me the right to judge or to divide the property between you two? And he went on to say to them all, Watch out and guard yourselves from every kind of greed, because your true life is not made up of the things that you own, no matter how rich you may be. And then he told them this parable. There was once a rich man who had land which bore good crops. He began to think to himself, I don't have a place to keep all my crops. What can I do? This is what I will do. He told himself, I will tear down my barns and build bigger ones, where I will store the grain and all my other goods. Then I will say to myself, Lucky man, you have all the good things you need for many years. Take life easy. Eat, drink, and enjoy yourself. But God said to him, You fool, this night you will have to give up your life. Then who will get all these things that you have kept for yourself? And Jesus concluded, This is how it is with those who pile up riches for themselves, but are not rich in God's sight. It's good to be wise. Wisdom is one of the things that we cherish. And when we find somebody who is wise, we will go to them for advice. And sometimes we wish we had more wisdom ourselves. If somebody says, Oh, come and give me your wisdom, we think, Who? Me? And yet, wisdom, true wisdom, comes from God. He is the only one that really knows everything. And we, as a human beings, just can't. The verse that we're given to set our hearts on the things that are in heaven where Christ is not saying that we should have our minds solely in the clouds and be of no earthly good. I don't think that's what Paul was trying to teach. I don't think that's what Jesus taught. But both are encouraging us to set our hearts on the things of heaven, on the qualities that God wants to give us through Jesus. When I was studying business studies, back in the olden days, one of the things that I had to learn was Maslow's hierarchy of needs. So that might ring bells with some people, that as humans, we strive for the things that give us our food and our shelter, and then we're looking for job security and family and good relationships. And at the very pinnacle of the pyramid is what Maslow calls self-actualization. We want to be content in ourselves. And in that way, that teaching that is there is saying we always need to be wanting more. We want to get more riches. We want to get bigger houses, bigger cars. We want to look successful to get to that point where we can look down on everybody else and say, I made it. That worldly kind of wisdom. often based on greed and lies. That worldly kind of wisdom that starts off with the work ethic, that we need to work really, really, really hard in life to try and get success, to try and gain the acceptance of our own selves by the community around us, to be loved. And finally, when we get there, we might reach this self-actualization, this knowledge of self that will give us the contentment that we so desire. But God turns that on its head. God turns that on its head in Jesus by saying, "Come to me, all you who are weak and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. In me you can find contentment. Come to me as you are. You are loved. You don't need to work to get there. You are valued. You are loved. You are accepted. You are successful because you are my child." And once we realize that in Jesus, and once we experience that love and acceptance that comes through Jesus and the Holy Spirit giving us that knowledge within us when we reach out to him, then we can feel loved. And that can be our motivation to work hard in this world. Not because we want to gain that contentment, but because we have that contentment. Greed and lies, trying to make it there on our own, don't make us happy and don't make those around us happy. They don't make us feel more loved, more accepted, wiser. The economy of today does teach this false idea that we need, even as economies, to get more and more and more. And it's always talking about growth and getting more stuff. Our GDPR in our country has to be bigger than the previous year. We want more as consumers to show that we're successful. We want bigger bank balances to be more certain that we can go forward in life. Always more, more, and more. But if you think about it, if everybody were to reach that self-actualization, if every one of the 9 billion people on this earth was to reach that level of self-satisfaction, we need more stuff on this earth than ever the one planet can carry. Because there isn't enough in that sense for everybody to have more and more and more, more than they need. But there is enough to go round. The planet was given to us to look after together and to share. And we've been learning in one of the courses I've done about donut economics, where everybody has enough not to be in that point of not having enough. That when we share, we can lift everybody out of poverty. But there's also an outer rim that we can't go beyond, because then we would go beyond the ability of the planet to provide. We can't live in a world where one or two have everything and everybody else hasn't got enough to survive on. That's not God's way. That's not God's wisdom. We need to be there for everyone to have plenty. both as an individual, that should be when we set our eyes on Jesus and what he wants to give us. He gives us more than enough that we want to share. Do we measure what we have in terms of what we give away? When we have too much, when we have too much money, too much things, I love the sharing apps that are there so that we can share things without wanting any money or any rewards back. But we share with the community. We share what we have because we have too much. Anything that gives more equally what is there. And when we're in board meetings or in community groups where we're making decisions, are we just bickering among ourselves and arguing among ourselves to try and get for my benefit, for the individual's benefit, or for the best for the whole community and the other communities around us? It is hard to live by those standards, but the Holy Spirit living in us can help us do that and find that help that we need to live wise lives. Every decision that we make, from what we choose to buy, to where we choose to go, to what we decide in every little way, from what we put on in the morning to what we decide to do with our time later in the evening. With hearts and minds set on Christ, every word, every thought can be for the good of all, the planet, the community, and therefore ourselves as well. That's what God wants to give us. And when we see those who live by those standards, we often see their faces shining. We see something in them that is just beyond them. The shining eyes of some just show what wisdom God can give. And we can know deep in our hearts when we're receiving that. That wisdom that God gives us, it says at the end of Colossians, is for to say that there is no longer any distinction between the Gentiles and the Jews, the circumcised and uncircumcised, barbarians, savages, slaves and free. We're all equal in God's sight. And everyone is welcome into the kingdom of God. And God will share his wisdom with whoever comes to him and wants to share it. And we should not put barriers to that. We should not say, oh, I'll only share my wealth, I'll only share my things with those who are like me. We should be sharing with everyone. We never know who may be in the greatest need, but Christ knows. And so, when we think about what we shop, when we think about sharing with the food banks, and I hope we remember the poor, when we think about worship and God and learning more about him and coming together in community to learn more about him, we can encourage others in all of these ways. As we encourage ourselves to focus on Christ, think of the things in heaven where Christ is, and from there will come our contentment. For us as individuals, for our community, and for our nation. I want to finish with a story. It's a story that I wrote the other week, as I was considering a gift that I was given. If it helps you to think about the gift as being the gift of wisdom, or any other gift that you feel that God may give you if you want and ask for it, then it might be helpful. The parable of the tiny tomato plant. The master gardener gave his new apprentice a young tomato plant early in the season with the instructions to keep it warm. It doesn't like frost, and to repot it into a larger pot and the fruit should come. The apprentice took the tomato plant home and did his best. He found a larger pot, well, a little larger than the one it was in. He filled it with soil from the garden. He didn't have a greenhouse, but brought the little plant inside on the frosty nights. As a month went by, it didn't die, but it didn't grow much either. The master gardener dropped by and looked at his gift, and the apprentice sadly said, "Sorry." He knew he wasn't that green-fingered, but he did want to try. "Let me help with it," said the master. "Give it back to me for a couple of weeks. Don't worry, it's still yours. I'll just get it going again for you. I'll put it back in my greenhouse and give it a good large pot and some nutrient-rich compost. If it dies, don't give me a different plant. I don't want to kill two gifts from you," said the apprentice as he went gloomily back to his house. A few weeks later, the master gardener dropped round with his gift. The apprentice couldn't believe his eyes at how much better the plant looked. "You didn't know how, but you tried, and now you can succeed. Look, it even has a flower cluster. There's fruit coming. And here's a new, much longer stake. You'll be needing that very soon." The apprentice followed the master's instructions. He watered the plant every other day and fed it once a week. And after a week, he had to attach the new taller stake because of the growth that had come. It had outgrown the little one he'd given it at the start. Then a week later, he spotted another flower cluster developing. Maybe there would be homegrown tomatoes that summer. It's a work where we need to stay within constant communication with the master gardener, in constant communication with Jesus. For there comes our help. We're going to sing again. It's a song, a new hymn, summoned by the God who made us, rich in our diversity, and we are so many and so different. But when we gather in Jesus' name, we're richer in our unity together, with the gifts that he gives us together as we share his wisdom amongst us.
Just feel in unity.
That thought that we can sing a new church into being, that together, wherever we are, we belong to the church when we call on Jesus. And as that, we can sing a new church into being because his wisdom is growing in all of us. And when we allow it to grow and encourage it to be nurtured, that new church, that new way of being is visible in all of us. Let's come together in our prayers of intercession. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, looking out for number one is rife in the way of the world. We pray for all who work for selfish gain to the detriment of others. Help them and us to see that working purely for personal pride and satisfaction is futile, and that serving you leads to everlasting joy. We pray for the lives of those who are neglected. Speak into their lives, Lord. Help them and us become aware of the relationship with you that can transform lives. We pray too for all who seek wisdom in purely human sources. May they and we understand that true wisdom and happiness can only be found in you. And Lord Jesus, we pray for all those caught up in webs of lies and deceit, the unethical and the immoral. We pray that you would break down the barriers preventing them and us from seeing the errors of their and our ways. Lord Jesus, as we bring to you our lives, the lives of the community in which we live, the people with whom we interact with every day, our family, our friends, our neighbours. As we bring to you those whom we watch suffering in other parts of the world, we pray that you would give wisdom to those who lead and govern. Wisdom to all who need to know you more closely in the decisions they make. That the decisions made at every level may be for the good of everyone. We ask this all in the name of Jesus, to whom we look to in heaven, who sends his Holy Spirit to enable us to live lives full of wisdom and contentment. We bring you these prayers in and through your glorious name, Lord Jesus. Amen. And our final hymn, My Soul Finds Rest in God Alone. My rock and my salvation. God is the one that gives us rest, and that is where we should look to. A new hymn, but a good hymn.
Thank you.
and a blessing. As a Christ-like community, Christ is all and in all. And we go trusting in him and his heavenly riches. We go to radiate his love, to show Christ, to speak Christ, to be Christ. Lord, as we seek your daily renewal, help us to become the people that you created us to be. Help us to live each day joyfully celebrating our new life in you, honoring your name in all we do and say. And so we echo that final hymn. Though riches come and riches go, may we not set our hearts upon them. We say together,
may the fields of hope in which we sow be harvested in heaven.
Amen. And come back next week for more wisdom from the Reverend John.
Lord, we come to ask your healing, teachers of love, all unspoken shame revealing, teachers of love. Take our selfish thoughts and actions, petty feuds, divisive factions, hear us now to you appealing, teachers of love. Soothe away our pain and sorrow, hold us in love. Grace we cannot buy or borrow, hold us in love. Though we see but dark and danger, though we spurn both friend and stranger, though we often dread tomorrow, hold us in love. When the bread is raised and broken, fill us with love. Words of consecration spoken, fill us with love. As our grateful prayers continue, make the faith that we have in you more than just an empty token, fill us with love. Help us live for one another, bind us in love. Stranger, neighbor, father, mother, bind us in love. All are equal at your table, through your spirit make us able to embrace a sister.